2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 20 reads, "For all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him amen, to the glory of God through us." We sing our first hymn on the sheet, "Who has held the oceans in his hand, who has numbered every grain of sand," and the chorus, "Behold our God seated on his throne." Let's remain seated as we sing. Father, your word has told us to behold our God. Father, we are not to have some casual glance only. We are not, O Lord, just to merely look and then look away. But Father, we are to behold with the eyes of our faith, and in one sense, never to take our eyes off of you, to behold our God. We worship you, O Lord. You are the one true and living God. There is none to be compared with you. There is none like you. You alone reign, the one supreme being, the one seated on his throne. You on your throne, O God, we worship you. We bow in our hearts before you, the one who is sitting above the circle of the earth, the one, O God, who has counted every grain of sand on the seashore, the one who created this world in which we live, who spoke and it came into being. And Father, in the unfallen state of this world, we thank you that you saw that it was very good. Everything that you do is very good. There is nothing to mar it. Everything that you do, O God, is perfect. And everything that you do lasts forever. For you are God, and you alone reign. And you truly are the one who is ever to be worshipped and trusted and adored and uplifted. How we worship you gladly from our hearts. We thank you that you truly exist. We thank you that you exist in the three persons of the Godhead. Not three gods, but one God in three persons. And Father, we thank you and we praise the name of the Lord Jesus. And we praise you for the Holy Spirit, all equally God, all God in their own right, but yet only one God. A mystery to us, O God. We can't fathom it. We can't work it out. We can't get to the bottom of it. We can't get around it. But Father, we believe it because of faith and that you have shown it to us, revealed in your word. And Father, we thank you for your greatness. Lord, your ways, they're past finding out. Father, who has known your mind and who has become your counselor? Oh, Father, for of you and through you and to you are all things forever and ever. We bow to your sovereignty. We are humbled by your majesty. And we come, O Lord, unworthy to call upon your name. Unworthy, O Father, of the least of your mercies, as Jacob prayed long ago. And Father, it's so relevant to our lives. But Father, we thank you that you welcome us, even though we're sinful creatures. And even though we've done so many things that are wrong and have marred, O Lord, our own selves and have brought dishonor to your name and offended your holy character. Yet, Father, we thank you that there is a way back from the dark paths of sin. Father, we thank you that there is a door that is open where we may go in. And at Calvary's cross is where we begin when we come as a sinner to Jesus. Father, we thank you that you did not leave this world in its mess. We thank you, Lord, that you did not leave this world in rebellion. But Father, we praise you that you sent your only Son, your wondrous Son, to come and to deal with the sin problem of this world. Father, all problems are symptoms of this greater problem of sin in the heart. And Father, we thank you that the answer, therefore, to our ultimate problem is the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you and we praise you that you have given us an answer. We thank you that the answer is in your Son. And how we praise you that the Lord Jesus came by you sending him into this world. We thank you, O Lord, for the perfect life he led. We thank you for the atoning cross he died on. We thank you that he cried, "It is finished." And we thank you that he rose again 3 days later. We thank you, O Father God, for the fact that he intercedes at your right hand even tonight. We thank you that he perfects your people's prayers when we pray. And so, Father, we know we make mistakes and stumble when we utter our utterances toward you, O God, but we thank you that your Holy Spirit is there to help us. And we thank you that the Lord Jesus takes of our prayers and presents them to you even now in heaven. Father, we thank you that we have that tremendous high priest, that wonderful advocate. And Father, we pray as we gather as a company of people, we ask that you would speak to us through your precious word. We pray that you would open up our minds that we might understand it. Father, we pray that you would warm our souls, that we would be not only defenders, but lovers of the truth as it is in Jesus. So help us then. May we focus upon you. No doubt there are many things that could occupy our attention. No doubt, Lord, there are many things that we plan to do in the week that has already started. But Father, we pray that for this evening time, that we would lay those to one side. We would lay our concerns to one side. We would lay our thoughts that come into our minds, so legitimate in many senses, the things that we're engaged in. But Father, we pray that we would focus on you. Give us understanding and help. And may we be blessed under the sound of your word. Hear us then. For Jesus' sake we pray. Amen. Let's open our Bibles, and our two readings are from Genesis. The first is Genesis chapter 17. Genesis chapter 17, reading from verse 15 to verse 22. And then Genesis chapter 21, reading from verses 1 to 7. Genesis chapter 17, reading from verse 15. Genesis 17, reading from verse 15, where the Lord has appeared to Abram. Then God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. And I will bless her and also give you a son by her. Then I will bless her and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be from her." Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, "Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." Then God said, "No, Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his descendants after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him, and will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. He shall beget 12 princes, and I will make him a great nation. But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this set time next year." Then he finished talking with him, and God went up from Abraham. And then chapter 21, reading from verses 1 to 7. And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son, who was born to him, whom Sarah bore to him, Isaac. Then Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Now Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. And Sarah said, "God has made me laugh, and all who hear will laugh with me." She also said, "Who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? For I have borne him a son in his old age." Well, we're going to have our pastoral prayer, and we're going to pray for gospel work. Hisham in Carcassonne has been involved in Week of Evangelism this last week. We've got GBM to pray for, and UBM as well. So there's been much gospel work that's been going on over these days in this summer season. So let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father and our gracious God, we thank you from our hearts for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, O Lord, for that great good news of the gospel. And Father, you have told us through the Lord Jesus that we are to pray, "Your kingdom come." We are to pray for the expansion of your kingdom. We are to pray for its advance. And Father, we are to pray in some form or another every day for the advancement of the gospel. And Father, we pray that we would gladly and willingly uphold people who have been laboring for you in the cause of the gospel over this summer season. And particularly of late, we pray, O God, for Hisham. We thank you, O Lord, for the skills and the great blessings you've given to him. And we thank you for the work at Carcassonne. And we pray, Father, for this last week of evangelism as they've sought to best they can in restricted circumstances to witness for our Lord Jesus. And we pray for all the contacts that were made. We ask that there would be a real turning to you, that there would be an inquiry after the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, O Father, for beach missions that have been able to operate, albeit in a very limited capacity because of the restrictions. But yet, Father, we thank you that they've been able to witness for Christ. We thank you for the work in St. Ives over this last week. And Father, we thank you for the work on the beaches and on the slipway in the open air. And Father, we pray for souls, precious souls, to be won to the Lord Jesus Christ. Boys and girls and men and women, mums and dads and grandparents and whoever they are, Lord, everyone is in need of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, that the world might taste and see. Oh, we pray that they would truly, as your word tells us, taste and see that the Lord is good. And Father, we also pray for the work of Grace Baptist Mission. We thank you for them and for the many years of labor with the various missionaries. We pray especially for Reuben and for Kathy Saywell as they plan to go to the Philippines and to plant a church in that place. We thank you for them and we pray for their preparations, Father. We ask that it would go well and we pray that you would guide them and lead them in the days ahead as they plan to go next year and plan very much to do it under the auspices of local churches and ascending church, O Lord, to send them in seeking to do it in a biblical way. And Father, we pray that you would bless their efforts in that poverty-stricken nation of the Philippines. Father, we praise you for Brian and Nellie Ellis over the years that you have blessed them in the Philippines. And Father, we pray that you would help them, O God, after many years of labor and service for you. We pray that you would be near them and bless them and strengthen them. And Father, we pray also that we, in some small way, would be able to tell others of the Lord Jesus. Father, we ask for ourselves this evening. We pray that you would help us once again as we come under the sound of your word. We pray that you would blow upon it by your Spirit. Lord, the Spirit blows where he wishes. And we, oh Lord, just like the wind. And Father, we do not know the sound of it. We cannot tell where it's come from or where it goes. But, oh Lord, it's a supernatural work. And Father, we pray for a supernatural work of your Holy Spirit to come upon every one of us. Lord, it's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by your Spirit, says you, the Lord of hosts. And therefore, as we come to your blessed word once again, grant us fresh manna from heaven tonight, as it were. We pray that you would speak to us afresh. Make us listen, O God, and may we put into practice the things we hear and listen to. So be with us then. For Jesus' sake, we pray. Amen. Now, we rightly talk about Abraham. Much is recorded in God's word about this wonderful patriarch, this head of a nation, head of many nations. He's the father of the faithful. The Lord Jesus said he rejoiced to see my day. He had the gospel preached beforehand to him. We talk a lot, and again, rightly so, about Jacob. His name means deceiver. And God used this scoundrel of a man, not approving, of course, of his tricks, but nonetheless, God had his hand upon him in his grace. And we talk about the God of Jacob, the God of grace. And we're thankful for the God of Jacob, aren't we? We're thankful for the God of grace. But so easily, Abraham's son and Jacob's father gets somehow sidelined. And his name is Isaac. There's reasons for that, I'm sure. Not as much in the scriptures is recorded about this man, Isaac. And so therefore we don't perhaps emphasize him as much as Abraham and as Jacob. But nonetheless, he is worthy of our consideration, isn't he? Lots of people talk about him when they go through Genesis, perhaps, and they might touch on his life when they talk about Abraham and Jacob. But in a concentrated way, in a focused way, there's not much spoken relatively about Isaac. And so therefore, I want us to look at this life of Isaac, this wonderful life. Not much may be recorded about him, but think about it. The longest chapter in Genesis is dedicated particularly about one issue relating to this man, Isaac. Very important figure. There was a significant moment in Israel's history. There was a man, and he was looking after his father-in-law's sheep. His name was Moses. And he saw an extraordinary sight. He saw a bush being burned. That wasn't the extraordinary sight. We'd have seen that a lot. But this bush was different. Why? Because it was burning but never burnt out. And so he turned aside to look at it. And a voice spoke from the midst of the bush. And it was the Lord. And the Lord said in the course of that conversation, as he commissioned Moses for the work that he was engaged in to do, he said, "I am who I am." And he went on to explain to Moses who he is, what that name means. Exodus 3, verse 15. "Moreover, God said to Moses, 'Thus you shall say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever. And this is my memorial to all generations.'" This is his name forever. So that means that it's his name tonight. He is the God of Abraham. Yes. He's the God of Jacob. Yes. But he's the God of Isaac equally as much. He's the God of Isaac. It's a wonderful title. The God of Isaac. And it's so important that we focus on his life. There's so much to teach us about the Lord Jesus Christ through the life of Isaac. There's so many lessons to learn through this man's history. And so tonight we're going to look at his promise and his birth. So there we have 2 points. We're going to look, first of all, at a promise. And then second place, we'll look at a promise fulfilled. So there's Abram. His shorter name to start off with, Abram, high father, exalted father. He was from a pagan background. He was from a heathen background that worshipped all kinds of gods, different gods. And God called this man Abram. He called him out of his grace. In one sense, he was no different to anybody else of that community. But he chose him unconditionally, out of his own grace. And he promised this man, Abram, many great things. He entered into a covenant with Abram. He told him to get out of his own family situation. Imagine for years and years, he was into his adult life, and he's told to get out of his own country that he's lived in, probably all of his life, to say goodbye to his family, to pack his bags, and to leave the place that he was so used to. To get out of his country and his family, to go from his father's house. And what's more is that the Lord didn't tell him where to go. We're told in Hebrews he went out not knowing where he was going. And on the bare word of God, Abram packed his bags and he went. What trust, what faith, what confidence he had in God. He went out not knowing where he was going at all. Took off. And God led him one step at a time. But in that initial promise, he told him that he would have descendants. And that his descendants would be great. That there would be a great nation. That all the families of the earth will be blessed. Well, how is that going to work out? Because we're told already in Genesis 11 and verse 30, but Sarai was barren. She had no children. A very important thing in Jewish culture to have children, but she was barren. Have any children? How's his promise going to be fulfilled? In fact, God comes to him and he comes to him on a number of occasions. And it's like a jigsaw that's being built up. And a bit more pieces are being added, and a bit more detail is being given. And finally, the full picture is there. And he comes to Abram on many occasions. And at one point, when God came to him after he rescued his nephew Lot, after they had gone their separate ways, the Lord said to him, "Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward." But Abram said, "Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless?" And he thought that the heir would come from a slave of his own household. "The heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus, someone who serves me. It's not going to come from Sarah. She's barren. She's beyond the age of childbearing. It's going to come from one of our slaves, from one of our servants." And the Lord said, "No, it's not going to come from Eliezer of Damascus." And the Lord confirms his promise. He gets him as he stares at the night sky. "Have you seen all the stars of the night?" He says, "That's what your descendants will be like, as numerous as the stars in the sky." He's already said that your descendants will be like the dust on the land. And he'll go on to say, it'll be like the sand in the seashore. He's your descendants. How is it going to come about? Well, Sarai's a bit naughty, isn't she? In chapter 16 of Genesis, she may have good intentions. She probably thought, "Well, look, I'm barren. It's not going to come through me, is it? Well, what are we going to do? Do I have to wait until I die? And then Abram can remarry? Or what's it going to be?" So she says, "Here you go, Abram. Have my maid. Have Hagar. And then the promised son will come." Shouldn't have done that. Sometimes we can maybe tempted to try and, if we can, help God along a little bit. Try and engineer things. Try and get involved, as Sarai did. But she was wrong. It was a lack of trust in God's promises and in God's timing. She may have had good intentions, but it was wrong. And Abram, he concedes. He goes into Hagar. He has Hagar as his wife. And you might have thought that it would work because Ishmael is born. Is this the promised son? Has Sarai's plan? She may have thought, "Why didn't I think of it before, maybe? But you know, there is Ishmael and he's been born." But the Lord has to say, it's not going to be Ishmael. He's not going to be the promised son. He's not going to be the heir. Ishmael was blessed of God, but he wouldn't be the promised son. And so the Lord comes to him again. And this time, Abram, how old is he? He's 99 years old. It's one off his century. And the Lord appears again to him. And he said, "Walk before me and be blameless." And it gives him more details, a few more pieces of the jigsaw are put into place. And he tells him even more information. He tells him that not only is it going to come from his own body, he changes his name from Abram, which means high father, to Abraham, which means father of nations, father of multitudes. And he strengthens his covenant with Abraham. And Sarai's name changes from Sarai to Sarah, princess. And then he says, "I will bless her and also give you a son by her." More information's been given. It's going to be through Sarah. Not only is it not through Eliezer of Damascus, your slave, it's going to come through your body. And not only is it going to come from your body, it's going to come from Sarah. Ah, but hang on a minute. Sarah's barren, which is why he said, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." He can't figure it out. It's beyond scientific possibilities. It's scientifically impossible. How many 90-year-olds do you see having children? It's not many, is it? It's not any. How's it going to happen? Through Sarah. God promises that Abraham, this man of 99 years old, and Sarah, who 90, to have a child. How could it be? They're beyond the age of childbearing. Because what's going to happen is there's going to be a supernatural birth. A supernatural birth. Now, doesn't that remind you about someone? And there are many parallels between Isaac and the Lord Jesus. Isn't the Lord Jesus? Did he have a normal birth? He had a supernatural birth, didn't he? Now, we can't take the parallel too far, of course. Isaac was born through normal generations, but the Lord Jesus wasn't. That which was conceived in Mary was of the Holy Spirit. She was a virgin, of course. We don't take it too far, but the basic parallel's there, isn't it? It's a supernatural birth. And he gives even more information to Abraham. He tells Abraham his name beforehand. Abraham and Sarah don't get to choose the name of their son. He says it's going to be called Isaac. That's the name of the child. That's what you're going to call him. Verse 19 of Genesis 17. Then God said, no, Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. Now, isn't that a parallel? Do you remember the just man, Joseph? He's engaged to Mary. Mary's expecting. He thinks, let's just divorce quietly. I don't want to make a big scene of this. So he thinks about it while he's on his bed. And the angel comes along, says, don't be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. There's another parallel that's gone on. The name is given beforehand of Isaac, and the name is given beforehand of Jesus. Names are so significant, particularly in those times. And Jesus, he means Savior. For he will save his people from their sins. He's a Savior. And by the way, he didn't just make salvation possible. He actually saves people. And he'll save his people from their sins. A great, tremendous confidence that we have in the gospel, that the Lord will save his own people. The question is, are you a part of God's people? Because Christ came to save his people from their sins. He came as a Savior of sinners, the Lord Jesus Christ, by his perfect life, by his substitutionary death, by his resurrection 3 days later. That glorious Savior that is typified in Isaac, this supernatural birth, this name that's given beforehand. There's another parallel, isn't there? What's that? Well, we're told that his covenant, the Lord's covenant, will be established through Isaac. Won't be through Ishmael. It will be through Isaac. Genesis 17, verse 19, at the end, I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and with his descendants after him. Now, do you remember in the New Testament when there was Zacharias? Who was he the father of? John the Baptist. And when he was filled with the Spirit and could finally speak, he gave testimony. Now, who did he give testimony to initially? It wasn't John the Baptist. It was the Lord Jesus. And he said in Luke chapter 1 about how the Lord was going to establish his covenant and establish his covenant through the Lord Jesus Christ. What did he say? Luke chapter 1, verse 73. The oath which he swore to our father Abraham to grant us that we, being delivered from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear. Verse 72, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. So the covenant is established with Isaac. And how is the covenant ultimately established? Through the Lord Jesus Christ. We're supposed to look through the gate of Isaac and see the Lord Jesus here, this glorious Savior in this typical form. Glorious Savior. And so time elapses. And one day Abraham is sitting in his tent. And there are three men that walk by. The providences of God, isn't it? Here's Abraham. He's just getting on with his life. He's just sitting there. He's just, you would have thought so insignificant, wouldn't you? Just Abraham sitting there. And three men come, and one of them asks about his wife Sarah. Now that must have got Abraham really thinking. Three strangers come, and they actually know the name of my wife. You'd be thinking, how do they know that? Well, of course, we know that one of them is a pre-incarnate appearance of the Lord Jesus. And he explains about how they have a child, and another few pieces of the jigsaw are put into place. They're told when Isaac will be born. At the set time, next year. And Sarah's listening. Genesis 18, verse 10. And he said, I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. And behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. Sarah was listening in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in years. And Sarah passed the age of childbearing. Therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I have grown old, shall I have pleasure? My Lord being old also? She couldn't believe it. She laughed. And then when she was told, well, why did you laugh? She said, I didn't laugh. She lied. But you did laugh. And she should have laughed. And we'll see the significance of her laugh in a minute. There's a promise. A promise of a son. A promise that got brighter and brighter. And Abraham and Sarah had to wait, and they had to wait, and they had to wait. And by the way, sometimes God, it doesn't operate on the same timetable as we do. And sometimes we do have to wait for the Lord's timings. And the Lord's timings are the best timings. So that there is a promise. Secondly, there is a promise that's performed. That's all very well. Promising amazing things. Are they going to happen? He's promising incredible things, is God, isn't he? Incredible things. Are they going to be performed? Don't forget, Sarah and Abraham, they're old. Is it going to happen? Well, we have Genesis 21, verses 1 to 7 in our Bibles, don't we? To say, yes, it did. Yes. You see, the Lord always keeps his promises. Remember that. The Lord was always a promise maker. He was never a promise breaker. And everything he says, you can bank on it, it'll come to pass. Even the impossible, even the ridiculous, even the scientifically impossible, it'll come to pass. It will. The Lord promised these aged couple that they'll have a child. Scientifically impossible. And yet, what do we read? Genesis 21, verse 1. What does it say? And the Lord visited Sarah. The Lord visited Sarah. Says that about Hannah, doesn't it? As an illustration, after she had had Samuel, she said that the Lord visited Hannah with three boys and two girls in 1 Samuel 2, verse 21. The Lord visited Sarah. Oh, that the Lord would visit us. Not with children, maybe, but in a powerful spiritual sense. The Lord visited Sarah as he had said. And in fact, in verse 1, it makes mention of this twice. It highlights it. It puts it in bold. It stands it out. He gets his proverbial highlighter pen out and highlight this, that it's already what the Lord has spoken. And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. So it's there twice. The Lord said that Isaac would be born, and Isaac was born. And the Lord said that his son would be born, would come into this world in human flesh. We have all of these promises in the Old Testament, and all of these predictions, and all the details about his life, where he would be born, what would happen at his death, years before Roman crucifixion was ever invented. Psalm 22, Isaiah 53, and other passages. His resurrection is promised before in Psalm 16. In verse 10, which Peter on the day of Pentecost says is about his resurrection. You will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. And all of these promises, how can we not grasp it? That it's talking of Christ. There's a Christ red line that runs through our Old Testaments. It's about him. Boiled down, the Old Testament is three words. He is coming. And the New Testament is three words. He has come. He is coming. He is coming. That's what it says. And the Lord promised. And will the Lord uphold his promise? Did the Lord uphold his promise to Isaac? Absolutely. Did the Lord uphold his promise about his son? With all the intricacies of the promise, not one of them was left unfulfilled. Not one of them was left broken. All of them was even the fact that he'd be betrayed is there in the Old Testament. So many details about his life, and they're all fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. Just like this was fulfilled about the promise of Isaac. Promise making and promise keeping God. He never reneges on his promise. He never goes back. Have you ever broken your promises? I'm sure when we look back in the cold light of day and we're honest with ourselves, and we've broken our promises, haven't we? We may have made them in all good intention sometimes. We may have promised something and said that we'd do it, and we haven't done it in the end. You know, God never does that. Never once. What he says he will do, he does. He never goes back. He never reneges. He never says, well, I didn't quite calculate that all right. And, well, I don't know if I can do that anymore. And I'm really sorry to let you down. He doesn't even send a substitute. He always keeps his promises, and he always keeps them on time. Always keeps his promises. We have a dependable, reliable God who breaks even the scientific laws to do so. Even the laws of nature. Even the laws of life, we could say, you would have thought would be ironclad. What happens? God breaks them supernaturally. God breaks supernaturally the laws of nature. His son is born of a virgin. He can't be born through ordinary generations because then he would have a sinful nature like us. So he's born supernaturally as a perfect son of God. The Lord said Isaac would be born, and Isaac was born. The Lord said his son would be born, and his son is born. The Lord keeps his promises. Verse 2 of Genesis 21. For Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the set time of which God had spoken to him. Do you see that? God not only kept his promises, God kept his promises to the letter at the right time. The Lord said, didn't he, with one of the three guests, this set time, and what happened? That set time, Isaac was born. And you know what happened with the birth of the Lord Jesus? He came at the right time. Paul tells us in Galatians, when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, born to redeem those who are under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. In the fullness of the time had come at the right time. At the right time, Abraham and Sarah had Isaac. At the right time, Jesus Christ came into the world. After all of those years of slavery and the children of Israel, and there's liberation. After all of those wilderness wanderings, after all of coming into the promised land, all of the kingly period, all of that, all of the prophets coming and going, and all of the silence in the intertestamental period, and finally in the fullness of the time had come, there God sent forth his son. God has a time for everything. Everything is in his time. And he doesn't operate on the same watch as we do. Wonderful that everything is right in his providence and his grace. All the details come true when the fullness of the time had come. A lady was once busy at Christmas time, and so busy that it got round to near the 25th of December, and she realized that she hadn't sent out her Christmas cards. Have you ever had that position? And so she thought, I better rush to the shops, to W.H. Smith or something like that, and go and buy a pack of Christmas cards to send to my relatives and friends. So she rushed off, she dived to the first pack of Christmas cards that she could find, and she paid the money and went home and busily wrote out these Christmas cards and wrote the address on the envelope and put the stamps on and sent them all out, and thought, phew, I've done it. Had Christmas together with her family, and afterwards, in the new year, she was putting away her Christmas cards with a few of them that were left over. And she opened up this Christmas card and she realized that it had a message inside, and it said this: this is just to say a present is on its way. There'd have been quite a few people disappointed, wouldn't there? Do you know, the Lord never disappoints when he promises. When he says, this is just to say a present is on its way, a present is on its way. And the present is his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. It makes the gospel even more incredible. It makes the gospel even more unique. After all of these years of promises, he comes. Virgin shall conceive and bear a son. A virgin conceives and bears a son. All the details are correct. It makes the gospel reliable and credible. And when people come and say, you can't believe the gospel, how can you believe this? Oh yeah, because of all the fulfilled prophecies. They add up. They stack up together. He comes. And notice that he was given the birth as we see his name beforehand. He would be called Isaac. Did Abraham obey that? Yes, he did. We're told, verse 3, and Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore to him. To make it absolutely clear, this came through Sarah, Isaac. He gave him the name that God had said he should have. And isn't that like somebody else? Do you remember Joseph? He was told, call his name Jesus, as we said, he would save his people from their sins. And what was the name given to him? Jesus. We're told in Matthew chapter 1, verse 25, about Abraham obeying that command to call his name Jesus. Matthew 1:25. And did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Both, another parallel for us. Abraham was obedient, Joseph was obedient, and the name intended for this promised son was given, Isaac. And the name for the promised son was given, Jesus. Promises were performed. Isaac. And what does the name Isaac mean? Well, the name Isaac means laughter. It means he laughs. Both of his parents laughed when they were told. It just seemed so ridiculous. Have you ever been told something and you've just been staggered by it, that you've just laughed at it? That's what Abraham did. He laughed at the promise way back in Genesis 17. And in verse 17, then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, is 90 years old, bear a child? He laughed. And you remember what he said a few moments ago about those three visitors. And one of them had said about Sarah and said, you laughed. But she said, I didn't laugh. No, but you did laugh. Oh, don't be afraid of laughing, because the son's going to be called laughter. Abraham and Sarah, they laugh, and so appropriately the name is given Isaac, laughter, laughter. The God of Isaac, the God of laughter, the God of the impossible, the God who staggers, the God who's incredible is the God of Isaac. Well, praise the Lord that tonight he's still the God of Isaac. Praise God that through this man, he's going to perform his promises. And there's going to be great Isaac's greatest son, who's going to come through his line. Because he's going to have a son called Jacob. And Jacob's going to have a son called Judah. And so on and so on and so on and so on. And then Christ is going to come through the line of Isaac. So if we can trust the promises of God concerning Isaac, and if we can trust the promises of God concerning Christ, we can trust all the promises of God, can't we? When the Lord Jesus Christ says, come to me, all you weak and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest, you can trust it. You can trust it. When the Lord comes to us and says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord, you can trust it. He's a promise maker. He never was a promise breaker. And if you're a Christian tonight, you can trust the promises of God. In him they are yes, and in him they are amen. God never leads you up the garden path. He never spins us a yarn. He never plays a puppet with us. He's straight up. He's straight honest. And what he says is true. A teacher was once offering his pupils a watch. And he said to the pupils, do you want this watch? So he said to one person in the class, let's call him Billy, do you want this watch, Billy? And he thinks, hang on a minute, that's a nice gold watch. There's something up here, there's some mucking around here. So he said, no, I'm all right, sir. Goes to the next boy, do you want this watch? And he comes to one lad and he says, do you want this watch? And he says, yes, please, and took it. He says, fine. And you know, sometimes people come with the promises of God and they say, well, how does he really mean that? Oh, there's something behind that. Oh, was that just for those people there and then? And then we can't have that promise. Is that really for today? That's not what God does with us. That's not what he did with Abraham and with Sarah about Isaac. And that's not what he does with us when he comes and promises about the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's not what he does to us when he promises us, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He's not saying, well, I'll sell that out of the one hand, but there's some ulterior motive here. He doesn't do that, does he? He doesn't toy around with us. His promises are yes, and in him are amen. They're not half-hearted. They're not disingenuous. They're plain. They're straight up. We may boldly say that the Lord is our helper. It's Satan who says to us, you don't want to trust the promises of God. Oh, you don't really mean what he said. Isn't that what he said to Eve way back in the garden? Has God said? He doubts God's words, but when he says it, he means it. So when he says to us and comforts us and says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, it's true. And we can take it for ourselves. If he's the God of Isaac who kept his promises to Isaac, and if he's the God who kept his promises through the Lord Jesus, he'll keep his promises for us. He never once reneges on them. He never once goes back on them. He is with us, isn't he? And sometimes we might get a bit worried and say, well, can I keep it up? And the promise maker comes and he says, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. And we say, thank you, Lord, for the promises. Thank you that they're right. Thank you they're true. He holds us in his embrace. And we'll continue to eternal life. And whatever doubts and difficulties we have, we come back to the scriptures. There's a very good devotional by Spurgeon. It's called this, in a typical Spurgeonic fashion, Checkbook of the Bank of Faith. Checkbook of the Bank of Faith. You know, the promises of God, they're like checks to us. And what we have to do is bank them. We have to bank them and benefit from them when he promises us. What a great God we have. Let's not have mean thoughts of him. Let's not think, can we trust him? We can. And let's remember, he is the great, great God of Isaac, the God of laughter, the God of the astounding, the God who keeps his promises and never breaks them. What a wonderful God we have. Let's worship him and serve him. Let's obey him and be diligent with him. And know that he is the God of Isaac. Well, let's sing our last hymn in conclusion. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.